Hey, welcome to Graphic Policy Television, GPTV. I'm Brett. It's Tuesday, which means it's New Comic Day, sort of. New comics are actually hitting the bookstores today. That means you can find all kinds of great comics hitting shelves at things like Barnes & Noble and Amazon, so on and so forth. This week is kind of an interesting one in that the book in my hand is actually coming out in bookstores, it seems, before comic shops. Today, Dark Knight, The Master Race, the third part of Frank Miller's Dark Knight trilogy, is out in bookstores today. It'll be out in comic shops tomorrow. In my hands, an uncorrected proof, so it's going to probably be a little bit different than the final product. And I have to say, it's a very interesting read. For those who don't know, Frank Miller has basically put out a epic story that goes back decades, kind of a major influence of today's comic books, and the original's kind of considered a classic. Second volume, well, it's probably best we forget that second volume, but this third volume, the question is, how does it hold up? Now, Frank Miller is joined again by Klaus Janson, and then also Andy Kubert and Brian Azzarello help as well. Interesting enough, this third volume is actually kind of good. So, in this world, Batman is still kind of the mystery. He's retired. He's got a sidekick that's helping him out. I'm not going to ruin things and spoil it for you. You're going to have to read and find out. And the big story is that basically religious fanatic Kryptonians get loose. They get bigger. And then they kind of bombard the world. Batman needs Superman's help as well as Wonder Woman's help to help defeat them. Really needs a lot of superheroes' help. Now, what's interesting is that going into this, kind of expected Frank Miller's worldview to be a major influence on the story itself, and it seems like Brian Azzarello might have had a lot more influence into it than, you know, I expected going into it. Now, not everything's like all like happy and go lucky and all that. This is a pretty bleak story, and you know, there's definitely a tinge of Miller's worldview on it, but it's actually a fascinating read to check out, mostly because it's really a fascinating one to dissect and think about and try to see what is being said. There's all kinds of topics being touched upon. Obviously, religious fanaticism is one of the big ones. For those who've read Miller's Holy Terror, you know why I say this is kind of a fascinating thing to read. There's also discussions of the media, police, just everything's kind of thrown in there. To me, this is more of a classic Frank Miller way back in the day of the 80s than it was Frank Miller in the 2000s, which is a good thing because Frank Miller in the 2000s went way off the rails. This is kind of getting back to, well, what was good about him. Now, it's obviously not quite as good as the original, but it's way better than the second volume, and it's one that I actually have enjoyed reading. Now, also interesting in this is that it's not just the main story, but there's a bunch of side stories about the various heroes that are still around in this world. Wonder Woman, Atom, Green Lantern, Flash, they're all touched upon, and we get to get glimpses of their lives in this world through a bunch of kind of like short stories. All that's actually really good matter that kind of adds to the story, and I enjoyed it immensely. I think what's really fascinating about all this is that in the end, the story actually kind of hinges on hope, and there is the story of you know, the theme that teamwork and perseverance is going to overcome religious fanaticism, and that there's hope at the end of the very dark tunnel. And you know, some people are probably going to read into that differently in different ways, but by the end of it, what I was expecting was not there. And that's actually a good thing, to be able to challenge the reader and challenge perceptions and actually make you think. This is the way comics should be. This is what sci-fi and entertainment does really, really well. It goes and uses the story to explore various themes, create allegories, and go from there. So when it comes to the story, really, really fascinated by this. And to be able to go and read this through in one sitting without the delays makes it even more interesting because there were some nasty delays between issues. The art is kind of classic art. It really does what you'd expect from Miller's Dark Knight trilogy really, really well. You know, obviously it's not necessarily Miller doing all the work, but you can definitely see his influences within, and overall the story kind of really plays off of what we've seen before. So, you know, in that way, it's really, really good. It's not quite the same that the first two volumes are, but put it all together, and I think it does well, fitting right in there. It's Andy Kubert's art, but you can see it's Kubert doing Miller, if that makes sense. That's really also helped by Klaus Janson, who I believe does the inks, does the inks, and, you know, his influence is clearly there. As far as extras, not really much of any. We get covers. Of course, we get the back matter. We get awesome covers like that. Love that cover. We get the back matter of, like, the short stories that appeared in the various comics. There might be stuff in kind of the final printed version of this, but I wouldn't necessarily know about that. But basically, everything is in here that you'd expect to be in here. It's a pretty epic story. There's lots of twists and turns. Overall, like, I like it. For those who kind of cringed and said, what the hell are they thinking? I enjoyed it. I think it defied my expectations. And overall, I have to recommend it. I mean, I am kind of blown away as to the quality of it. While, as you know, it's not the heights of the original Dark Knight, it is still a very entertaining read. And well worth picking up, especially to kind of see the arc of the trilogy overall. And I enjoyed it enough that I actually would be willing to see a maybe fourth addition to this storyline. So this is out in bookstores today. It'll be out in comic shops tomorrow. Now, if you've got a comic shop near you, you should go to your comic shop and go and support them first and foremost. Without comic shops, the entire comic industry would be having a hell of a time. Well, it might not exist. If you don't know if you have a comic shop near you, you should go to the link beneath this video. There is a link. You go put in your zip code to help find a local shop. If you don't have a local shop near you, then you can go to bookstores, Barnes & Noble, Amazon, stuff like that, and buy it from there. We got some links beneath this video. They're affiliate links, so they do help support our site. But purchase through it, you support our site. I want to thank DC Comics for hooking us up with this. I've been waiting to talk about it because, well, it's been a very interesting read. The multiple times that I've read this at this point. So thank you so much, as always, for supporting us. And thank you for watching. Now, if you're into comic books, DC Comics, Batman, Frank Miller, Brian Azzarello, Adam Kubert, you should go, or Klaus Janson, you should check us out every single day at graphicpolicy.com. We're on Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, Tumblr, all at Graphic Policy, keeping it nice and consistent. Until next time, as always, thanks for watching, and keep it geeky. Hey, thanks for watching the previous video from Graphic Policy Television. Just by watching, you help support our site. Thank you so much. Now, if you're watching these videos, you probably care about geeky things like movies, television, comic books, toys, games, video games, you name it. You can go and subscribe right now to our YouTube channel to stay in touch and catch all the new videos, or check out our website at graphicpolicy.com. There's a nice link on this end of the video. But as always, thank you for watching. Keep on rocking and keep it geeky.